Trinidad and Tobago in the red and black kits.
On there, driven across towards the penalty spot,
affecting the players.
Long distance black.
Yeah, so I think it's, I've got to point out that these guys that have trained with us for over a year now through 2020, the entire squad that is leaving Trinidad and Tobago are not on contract. They haven't got clubs. They're not earning a living. It's, you know, these guys have had a very tough year, stroke 18 months of football here in Trinidad and Tobago. We recognise the hardships and the problems that we've had behind the scenes with the different politic in which we've tried to sidestep, so we get the youngsters back on the playing fields, working hard together. We've gone through 325 players over the course of 2020. The guys that we've got training with us on the ground now are the best of the bunch. They've done a terrific job. Fitness levels are very good. It's a much younger squad than Trinidad and Tobago has had for quite a while. And we've taken on a game against the United States of America that are throwing people out like Josie Altidore and Chris Muller, players that are renowned top players. Altidore, of course, has played in the Premier League in England. He's now a top player in the United States, MLS. Muller, great goal scorer for Orlando, the destination in which we're playing the game. So we knew this was going to be a very big call. And this was me thinking, let's get going with something that's a huge brand. It's possibly the biggest brand in CONCACAF football. I want our players to be taken seriously. So we've sidestepped the likes of Anguilla, that I think have been an embarrassment in the past. We recognise this is not going to be easy. Players that we're playing against are all structured, organised. They've played in the national sides at 17, under 20 level, and now the national team. Many of the players that are top ranking players in the USA now are under 23. And, you know, you guys have got to recognise that some of the main players for the United States of America today are playing for Bayern Munich, Barcelona, Chelsea, some of the biggest club sides in the world. So these guys have got to be taken seriously. We're brand new, we're young. I've got two or three players in the squad that give me a little bit of experience that are older. Good examples, good role models, people that I'm relying upon to deliver the message as well as myself. But we always knew this was going to be tough. But I think this is exactly what Trinidad and Tobago football need. We still are without Pro League football, Super League football. There's no football on the ground, not even schools football. Yes, we can look at coronavirus. It's been horrible for the last 18 months. But the rest of the world are playing football, and indeed the rest of the region, everywhere else in the Caribbean, their local leagues are competing, and we are not doing that in Trinidad and Tobago. The only side that have engaged at any level has been my national team. Again, they've done a great job. I'm proud of the way they're moving on, but this is a big, tall order for them. But bring it on. Yeah.
Aside from great world round, the opportunity to take the team out and
yes,
engage them competitively. Tell us about some of the fears or concerns that might be floating around regarding virus, quarantine, and that sort of thing. Does that exist?
Well, we're looking around the world now. You've got the UK, where I'm from, absolutely nailed, bolted down. You can't move anywhere. And it's 14 days quarantine to go anywhere, it's 14 days quarantine to come back. It's not easy out there. But at elite football, which international football is, Premier League football, Champions League, they've managed to get by that. and these guys are training hard, taking things seriously. They're not overstepping the bounds. They're looking after themselves properly behind the scenes. We've got to be the same. With all due respect, I think government have handled things very well. We've not got a lot. We've got one case of the new strain that's hit Trinidad and Tobago. Please God, they can maintain and handle that properly. But we're not playing football anywhere else other than my national squad. So it's difficult. Taking into consideration the level of the teams that we've played against, which have been regional 11s, we've looked great, but it's not against the United States of America that are bringing top class international stars that are known and renowned across the world.
Just help me to understand, I guess, some of the logistics of this encounter. How will the team leave and come back? Is it by charter?
So we're chartered to Guyana. We're from there up to Miami. From Miami, to keep things nice and simple and safe, we've got a coach ride, which I believe is 2.5 hours to Orlando. So that then will be straight to the hotel where we're stopping. And then on the way back, we're straight from same coach ride back to Miami, flight directly into Trinidad. Straight after training today, we're in quarantine. Everybody will be checked up. We'll be given tests later this evening, I believe. So everybody will be on top of themselves going forward. We will announce the squad after this today. So you'll have an idea of the people that we're bringing in and blending from the US. Again, all of the guys that we're bringing from the US, which there are a number, I've not seen them play. I recognise their names. I recognise the leagues that they're playing in and the clubs that they're playing for. They're obviously good players, but I haven't seen them on the training ground. I've not seen them play physically myself. So the trip that we've got will be a lot of one-on-ones with them guys, find out what they're about individually, find out what qualities they bring to the team. Are they better than what we've already got? So it's a mix and match of sorts against the top team in our region.
What kind of result are you expecting against the United States?
What sort of
result are you expecting?
Well, I want something positive, obviously, but I recognise that we're playing against a top team. They've got excellent players within their side, and the two names I've mentioned already, Josie Altidor, everybody in the world knows that name. They recognise him. You've got Muller, who's playing on his home ground, is a top goal scorer. They've got quality in every position. The United States, what is it, 350 million people. Soccer's now right up the top of the tree there because they recognise how good it is around the world. It's the biggest paying sport on the planet. So they've put a great deal of money, effort, expertise. Their development record has been phenomenal over the last 5 to 7 years. That's why they're producing such good players at this time. So we know we're up against it. But at some stage, Trinidad and Tobago have got to get back on the map. We've got to be playing against the best in the region. And that's my intentions. Let's get us back to where we should be.
Last time you played the US, we lost to 6-0. Are you concerned that a result like that again will demoralize the team?
It's a big ask. Again, the quality is right in front of you. Everybody will see what they've got. We've been working hard behind the scenes to be organised, structured, have discipline about our play, how we're going there to upset them. My starting 11 will be quite young, which you'll see when the squad's announced. But they've been working hard, and I've said to them, and I've said to the press and media over the last 12 months, we've got some wonderful talent on the ground in Trinidad and Tobago, but we are soft between the ears. The mental side of the game, we are lacking in badly. And that's because of the lack of structure within the Pro League, the Super League, the lack of training that they get on the training ground with their club sides. My God, we've trained for a whole year. The only club that didn't participate was Le Hockey de Rangers, that will not allow their players to play with the national team. That's the politicking that we've got going on in the background that people out there should know. So it's not easy. It's not going to be easy against the US here. But it's a starting position that I hope will get not just my players, my staff, my everybody technically up and running, but behind the scenes, more than anything, we need to smell the coffee, get football going again in Trinidad and Tobago, and I hope this could be the catalyst to do that.
Sorry, Gary. No, I mean, several of the players on both sides will be making their international debuts. It's also your international debut in terms of this.
Yeah.
And it's quite a difficult match to really to get into international football.
Yeah. Vidya, you know me for a long time now, mate, and you know the character that you're dealing with. I've got a lot of belief and confidence in the young players that we've had for the last year. Within that last year, we've had 6 and 8 weeks where we've not trained ourselves because of the restrictions on the ground here in Trinidad and Tobago. But I'm a big believer in what you put in is what you get out, and we've worked hard, we've structured, we're well organised, we're better than anything else on the islands here. My priority is Guyana on the 25th of March. That's the World Cup qualifier. United States of America is a big call. It's a big starting position. It's a big first game for me and for many of my players. But we need to progress the game. We need to get our guys comfortable with the big occasion. It doesn't get any bigger than this video. And some will say, oh, we're throwing these kids under the bus. What an experience for them. What an experience to play out their first game against the United States of America.
How much is this Terry Fenwick's team, in the sense that you have gotten the opportunity to put what principles of play into
this
team?
Again, Vidya, it needs to be noted that we've only got access to a number of players that may be out of contract with MLS clubs in the United States. A lot of the renowned players that we know, like the Molinos, are resting. They're just signing contracts. They're not available for this particular game. So we're having to scramble on the ground. We've also identified, you know, as many as 12 to 14 players in the UK that just can't travel, lockdown, that we would hope to bring in by the time World Cup qualifiers come around. And it's a fusion of players, top quality players, that we need for the World Cup coming round. But this is a starting position. It's against the top team in our region. They're doing great things. Their development process is second to none. They've done an absolutely amazing job behind the scenes to bring all of these youngsters through as they have. We need to be on that 1.3, 1.4 million people in Trinidad and Tobago. The quality of kids that we've got, and there's no development process at all on the ground, tells you we're going down the wrong street. I want to change that up. I need support on the ground from people in Trinidad, and there's some good people out there. I need support from you guys in the press and the media to bring some positives to the forefront rather than negatives that we've been too familiar with over the last 18 months, 2 years. It's a big ask, but I want everybody to please get on side and help where they can, because corporate Trinidad could do a great deal more. The club sides here in Trinidad could help, and of course schools football and that is all a part of the development process.
We have time for two more questions. Go ahead. Coach, you mentioned the fact that you're happy to sidestep opposition, you might still have to go there, etc. And many would have thought that given our recent history, both in terms of performances as well as internal turmoil, that securing a game against a team like the US would be more difficult. Trinidad and Tobago would be an undesirable opponent in our knowledge.
Yeah.
How confident are you, or how much would you want to see more games of this magnitude, or would you prefer, based on his result, perhaps the result against the US, to play teams a little closer to our level?
Well, I think what we're doing, this Jazzy gets everybody's attention, which it has. United States of America doesn't get any bigger than that. When we return from the United States, we're hoping to have a 3-team tournament, including 2 other teams within the Caribbean region, right here in Trinidad. so we can get our feet again, we can find our way again. We're hoping we're going to come back with full of confidence. We know we're playing against the top team in the United States. It might be difficult for us, but we've got to stick together as a team on and off the field of play. That's what I'm trying to get. We've got a wonderful passion and commitment and team spirit going on already. I'm feeling that already from the players, the staff that I've picked. I've not got a big load of staff members that the previous administration have. I've kept it nice and tight. For that exact same reason, I want us all fighting together for the right reasons. I don't know, I'm not cared. It's politicking, and again, Trinidad and Tobago, it's something that we're all familiar with. It's not the first time, it's happened for a while. And we just let them get on with them, and we've moved on with kids that want to play for their national side.
So do you would still keep an eye on some players at least that are
there? Of course, there's no bias on my side.
Would you perhaps be so bold as to know which players from that organization?
Well, the goalkeeper's been terrific over a couple of seasons now. But you see, Jesse, I don't get involved. I'm disappointed in the politics, but I don't get involved in it, really. And I'm looking at the way we need to stick together. We need a team that are working hand in hand to move football forward. We haven't got that at the moment. But only if we make strides like playing against the United States of America, that are doing exactly that, putting a great development program together. Their levels at 15, 17, and 20 are now the best in our region. They're knocking on the door of World Cups wherever they play. They are miles ahead. We need to get serious and move our football on also.
Players like Karen Cummings, Atiladera, Russell Jr. all involved with that team, players with international pedigree and experience.
Lots of them.
Well,
we'll miss them, of course, but they're all getting on. You know, what was very evident to me in the last World Cup qualifiers back in 2018, we had the oldest squad in world football. And I know the kids that we've got on the ground, and some of that is because of the, not so much the politics, but kids are still playing college league football at 18, 19, 20. It's too old. They're not doing that around the world today. Or if they are playing at that age, they're not good enough for their national sides. So we need to make breaks within that. So at 16, 17 age group, if you're good enough on the football field, you can do your academics at a professional football club, which is happening everywhere. All over Europe, North America now. If you're linked with a professional team, you're also doing your work off the field on your academics or a skill set of some sort, if indeed you don't make it.
You ventures so far, let us know which players from Rangers have been invited.
I'd rather not go there, mate. It's why give them any? They've made a stance.
I know, but for the players, at least they know that Terry Penny is still interesting.
No, I mean, some of these players reach out, of course they do, and we're not ignoring them, but I wouldn't want to throw any focus on them as individuals, because it's not fair on them. So I'll keep that to myself.
I know he's involved in training, and you still get to release your final squad.
Yeah.
A lot has been said about Gary Griffith Jr.
And
his involvement with the team.
Well, he's one of the only I think him and Jesse are the only contracted players from Trinidad that are leaving with us. So they've got contracts with Coleraine in Northern Ireland, which Coleraine, I'm not sure whether you're aware of, but they competed in the early stages of Champions League, so they're playing at a good standard, a good level, and they bring back with them the experiences that they've got. Again, Jesse, you've got to recognise that most of the players that I'm coaching right now have done absolutely nothing competitively for well over a year. That's ridiculous. We've got a World Cup qualifier coming in 8 weeks, so I need people that are competing, that are fresh and bright in their mind, and different and structured different to what we've seen on the ground in Trinidad.
Okay. Coach Fenwick, thank you very much, gentlemen. Thank you. Sean, join us at the training pitch for 15 minutes for media review.
Sean, if you don't care, just go through the logistics that you were explaining earlier, so we can have it on tape.
So, as Coach Fenwick mentioned, the actual traveling contingent that leaves this country on Tuesday morning everybody will receive their PCR tests following the training here today at Ato Boldon Stadium, and then immediately go into quarantine at the home of football. This is going to be the first time in over a year that the national team has access to the facility. So we're looking forward to that, and we will be in quarantine until Thursday morning. The team will train over the next couple of days here at the Ato Boldon, and then depart on Thursday morning for Orlando via Guyana. We will immediately arrive in Miami and then take it by bus to Orlando. We'll be staying in a bubble there with the overseas based players. We'll join the local contingent that are leaving these shores. We'll have approximately 4 training sessions over the 2 days leading up to match day. Then we play on the 31st, depart Orlando via Miami and head back into Port of Spain. But obviously as well, we also have on the ground in Orlando a former Queen's Royal College footballer, former goalkeeper, Dr. Mario John, who's an orthopedic surgeon based in the US, and he's our medical laser that has been lasering with US soccer with regards to all the protocols that need to be followed and ensuring that everything is in place for the arrival of Trinidad and Tobago team in Orlando on Thursday. We expected to return on the game is the 31st, so on the 1st we should be back in Trinidad.
7 days,
so immediately following the return to Trinidad, the team enters again 7-day quarantine at the home of football. As Fenwick mentioned earlier, we are hoping to try to get a Tri-Nation invitational series with 2 Caribbean teams. So they also, once that is confirmed, they may possibly fly into the country at the same time and go into the bubble at the home of football. Yeah? Good?